We wanted to talk a bit tonight about understanding the anointing, working with the anointing, working in the anointing, understanding what we carry, what God has given to us, and the amazing benefits of the anointing. Because how many people know it's the anointing that we need? Amen? How many people really want to understand the anointing and work with it? Because it's great. And it was a great testimony this morning, because we've been talking about that the anointing is tangible, and how you can release the anointing from your life and let it be activated over people's lives. See, if you don't release it, nobody will ever know that you've even got it. But you release it and it touched people. And this gentleman spoke about his daughter, how he just went over and started to pray for her. But as he prayed for her, he started to do what we were teaching. And he started to let that anointing flow out of his life. And she said that she could feel something. She said, "Dad, what's going on here? Well, I can feel something." And you know, I'm going to tell you, some people say that it's not by feelings, but I want to tell you, it's better felt. Amen.
Yeah.
It's wonderful to experience. Anybody ever experience the presence of God that just comes over your life and touches you, and it's like God giving you a hug or something like that? And that's the amazing thing. Amen. So tonight, Father, we just give you all the praise. We give you all the glory. My God, tonight I pray that you would help us to understand, so we can operate and flow with you and not resist you, or when we sense these things coming on our lives, we think, "Oh, what is that?" But instead we'll say, "That must be you, Lord," and we'll just flow with you, and we'll learn to move in the Spirit, because we are in the school of the Spirit. And Lord, tonight I just ask you that you'll help us in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. See, the anointing, I believe we, the church, need to understand the anointing that God has provided for every believer. I want you to say every believer.
Amen.
It's not just for Benny Hinn. It's not just for Oral Roberts or some of the great men and women of God that we've known and heard about. It's for every believer in this day that we're living in. We don't have to wait for flashes of lightning. We don't have to wait for the trumpet to sound. We don't have to wait for this or that. It's already in us. It's already around us. And I believe that God wants to stir that up inside us, and that we start to manifest it with it and start to work with the mighty Holy Spirit. In Romans 5:17, the Bible says this. It says, if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more, everybody say much more.
Much more.
Not just a little bit, but much more, those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one Jesus Christ. God wants you and I to reign in life. He wants us not just to make it through, but he wants us to reign in life. It's because of the anointing that we are able to reign in life. It's the anointing that allows us to reign in life. To reign means to rule over. To rule over not one another, but to rule over principalities, powers, to rule over sickness, diseases, over all the works of Satan. Do you believe that today?
Yes.
So what we've got to do, we've got to understand, because sometimes some scriptures seem to contradict and things like that. In Zechariah 4:6, the Bible says this. The angel who spoke to Zechariah said this. He said, "This is the word of the Lord." If ever there's a day we need to hear the word of the Lord, it's today. Amen. Hear what God is saying. He said this to Zerubbabel. "It's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord." The angel here is warning about natural and human ability. Natural power, human power. And he's saying to Zerubbabel, it's not by power or might of an army, but by God's spirit or the anointing that the battle will be won. And I say this to you today, friend, the battle that every one of us is facing can be won and will be won by the anointing of God, by the presence of God, by God's anointing itself. In Judges chapter 7, verse 2, there's a story there of Gideon, how God finds Gideon in the threshing floor, and he comes up to him and says, "Gideon, you mighty man of valor, God is with you." And of course, Gideon looked at himself and said, "I'm a nobody." But eventually gets to a point in his life where he starts to believe what the Word of God was saying. I believe that we, the church, have got to come to a place where we believe what God says about us and not what we feel about ourselves. A lot of people feel like they're a failure because they've made a mistake or something like that. But God has got confidence in you and I that we will rise up and allow that anointing on our lives to operate and for God to be able to manifest himself through us. Does that make sense to you? God wants to do it through us. And so Gideon is on the scene there, and eventually Gideon gets to a point where he says, okay. And he starts to do what God says he can do. And so he gathers a great army of 32,000 people. And then God spoke these words to him. He says, hey, he said, there's too many. And it says there, it says, lest Israel claim glory for itself against me. Unless they think it was by their own hand that they were saved. Brent, I don't know about you, but I cannot save myself. I need God. I need the anointing. I need the presence of God. And here is an army that God had to remove 31,700 of the troops and left them with a mere 300 people so that they would know that it was God alone. It's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. Lest they think by saying, my own hand has saved me. It's by the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, that the battle is going to be won. In Isaiah 10:27, it says this, and it shall come to pass in that day that his burden will be taken away from your shoulders and his yoke from your neck, and the yoke will be destroyed because of the anointing oil. I believe that there's a special anointing that God is pouring out upon his church in this hour that you and I are living in. And let me just read to the end. And it will come to pass. How many people believe that whatever God says will come to pass? Yes. And it will come to pass. You know, a lot of people, where I think a little bit this morning, Joe and I have been talking about the yoke and the pressure and different things that come upon us. But God wants to take that away by the anointing. The anointing of God will cause people, unlearned people, to rise up. It will cause people there that perhaps do not know a lot of things, but they'll be able to speak the mind of God. They'll lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. I heard a gentleman one time there that he'd done something terrible and he'd been excommunicated from the church. It wasn't adultery or anything like that, but there was something there in his character, something there in his life. This was overseas. And he was so downtrodden and so broken, and he was walking down the street and he started to cry out to his God. You see, so something there that opens heaven. When God sees real people, real, perhaps with a real problem, but you start to cry out to God, this, I believe that there's going to come a cry out of the people of God in Australia that's going to cause his very presence to come down. We hear individuals and different things like this. And this young man, as he was walking down the road, and he was crying out to God, he said, oh God, I failed you, I've made a mess. And he's carrying on, but he says, oh God, I love you, you know I love you, you know my heart. And he was just crying out to his God. And as he was walking down the road, all of a sudden, he could hear a commotion beside the road. And there was a village not far in from this road that he's walking along. And there's a woman in there and she was wailing, and there's other people there that were weeping and crying. And he walked, and got his attention, and he walked into this village. And there was this woman with a little baby that had just died. And he felt the Spirit of God say, take that little baby and pray for it. And he went over there and he took that little baby in his hands and his arms and he started to pray for it. And all of a sudden, life came back into that little baby. And the whole village, they said that whole village got born again. And this young man built a great church in that village and other villages. See, what I'm saying here, it's the anointing, it's the presence of God, to be led by the Spirit. You and I are just mere men and women, but I want to tell you, God doesn't want us to see ourselves that way. We can be anointed with the mighty Holy Spirit power. We can have the fire of God burning in our bones. God can do exceedingly abundantly above what we can imagine or think. And here's a big man, one minute in total depression and total failure and defeat as the enemy just stole so much from him. We're talking about going into the enemy's camp and taking back what the devil stole him this morning. Amen. But tonight, rather, and I believe that that's what's going to happen. Amen. This anointing, and it shall come to pass in that day that his burden will be taken. This is what the enemy's put on us. Will be taken away from your shoulders and his yoke from your neck. And the yoke will be destroyed because of the anointing. By the anointing, how many people remember this story? Jesus breaks the yoke. By the Holy Ghost and power, just as the prophet spoke. This is the day of the latter rain. God is. Everybody say, God is moving in power again. Amen. By the anointing, Jesus breaks the yoke. The yoke of sickness, the yoke of depression, the yoke of fear, the yoke of intimidation, lack of self-esteem, poverty, whatever it might be, and any other thing that the devil tries to put on you. I want you to open up your Bibles, if you've brought them, to the Philippians. Amazing book. Philippians chapter 2. Philippians 2 and reading from verse 5. And he said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, and coming in the likeness of man, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee would bow, of those things in heaven and those things on earth and those things under the earth. God has given him a name which is above every name. Let this mind be in you. And I want to say today that we've got to have our minds renewed. There's got to come a changing. There's got to come something that's different on the inside of us. In 2 Corinthians 10 verse 3, it says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God for pulling down strongholds. We're speaking today about the mighty anointing of God. We're talking about the presence of God. We're talking about that anointing that God wants to put on every life. In the Old Testament, the anointing did not rest on every church member. It was not in them and it was not on them. They would anoint certain individuals to stand in the office of king, priest, and prophet. King David, as a type of Christ, operated in all three of offices. Today we have a better covenant, amen? But today God still anoints kings, priests, prophets, and so forth. We are, as a believer, filled with the Holy Spirit. We are all kings and priests, and we all have the mind of Christ. We can all operate in the mighty Holy Spirit. Let's look again at Zechariah 4:6, where he said, it's not by might, and it's not by power, but it's by my Spirit, says the Lord. This power that he's talking about is a natural power. You know, sometimes there we hear people, especially when we start talking about the Holy Ghost and what the Holy Ghost can do, and people say, if you get too much power, you'll blow up. And they try to, pull down the power of God. I want to tell you, if there's ever a day that the church needs a double dose of the power of God, it's today, amen. There's so many things that you and I need to be able to destroy and break the strongholds over. So this power is a natural power. But what we're going to understand is in Luke 4, verse 14, it says that Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit. So there's a spirit power, there's a natural power, but he said it's not by natural power, it's not by natural might, but it's by my Spirit. But if you can get a hold of the Spirit, you'll get the power of God as well, amen. You'll get the might, you'll get everything that you need to overcome and to triumph. So Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit. In Acts 1:8 it says, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. In the Old Covenant, God was in the Holy of Holies. When Jesus died and rose again, the curtain was rent in two. God's presence was in the Holy of Holies, but now it rests on every believer. His presence is in this room now. Do you believe that? Yes. But you see, in the Old Testament, it fell on a group of people, and these people then, they went out and they ministered, or they told what God was doing. But today, you and I have all got the mind of Christ. Today, we can hear directly from God. Amen? we can hear God's voice. We can hear what God's saying. And we can start to move in the Spirit of God. God's presence was in the Holy of Holies, but now it's on you and me. Can you sense His presence from time to time? Let's have another look at Luke 4:14. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit. There is an anointing on you, whether you recognize it, believe it, or not. There is a resident anointing on you right now, and God wants you to work in that, whether you recognize it or not. We all have a mandate from God to go into all the world and do. When Matthew was sharing the other last week, he talked about God having a name, G-O, go. But if you spell it backwards, it's D-O, go and do. And Satan's name, half of his name, is Sat. And most Christians, Sat, instead of going and doing, amen? I believe that the anointing opens the supernatural realm to us. In Acts 38, it says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went around doing good, healing all who were oppressed by the devil, because God was with him. Luke 4 again, it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach, to heal, to do whatever it was. It was the anointing. What is the main hindrances that stop us from doing the same things? What hinders man? You know, what happens is we think that Jesus, somehow or other, He was the Son of God, which He was, amen? Jesus was the Son of God. Because He was the Son of God, He had all these attributes, He had all these things, He had the Holy Ghost and beck and call, and so forth and so on. But you see, you've got to realize that Jesus became a man. Jesus emptied Himself of all the authority and stuff that He had as the Son of God, and He humbled Himself and became a man, and He walked on this planet as a man, and He had to rely on everything that you and I rely on so He could operate in the gifts of the Spirit, so He could do the things that God had told Him to do. Otherwise, it would be impossible for you and I to do it. Because we'd be just thinking, he's the Son of God. We think Jesus is the Son of God, and I'm just a sinner, saved by grace, and I'll never be good enough. If you think like that, you exempt yourself. You exempt yourself from what God has done for us. There's so many people today that in the church that exempt themselves because they think, well, I can't do that, I can't do that. I want to tell you, God will surprise you if you start to activate and move and do with the things that God has already given you. You will surprise yourself what is already inside of you. I've told you the story many times of how I started praying for people that were sick and feeling that I didn't have the anointing. Clark had the anointing. Somebody else had the anointing for that sort of thing. So when somebody got sick, we would always take them to the pastor. We'd take them to that person. It still happens today when somebody's sick. Friend, I don't notice it so much in this church because I believe you guys have known a lot more. You pray for people today. But in most churches, I'll bring the person to the pastor because he's the one that's anointed. What you're doing is you're exempting yourself from moving in what God has on your life. So you've got to realize that it's there. And if I'm just saying, well, I can't do it, and so, you know, we've got to go to the pastor or something like that and get him to do it. And this time, that you know, I went out to visit this person and knocked on the door, and eventually I got in there. And the lady's on the floor sick, laying there in agony, and I looked at her and I thought, you poor woman, you know, dear me. And she said, I'm in agony, and I thought, oh. And she looked at me and she said, praise the Lord. She said, I've been praying for somebody to come. And I thought, you poor lady, you got me. Clark's in the office somewhere, I don't know where he is, but you've just got me. But I had to pray for her. And as I prayed for her and I did the best, then the anointing started to flow out of me. Love and compassion flow. I felt sorry for the poor lady, and I wanted to do whatever I could, but all of a sudden something came out of me and she got totally healed. Blew me out of the water, but I started to realize that you know, perhaps I carried something, you know what I mean? But you see, every one of us carries that same anointing. Every one of us carries that same mantle. It's not a man-given thing, it's a God-given thing. And He gave it to you when you got born again, when you got filled with the Spirit of God. Otherwise, He wouldn't say, lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. He's not having a joke with us. But what happens is we exempt ourselves. Can you catch what I'm saying here tonight? So we've got to get out there and start doing some things and opening up the things. That, I believe, is the main hindrance. We think that I'm just a sinner and I'm not good enough. You think like that, you exempt yourself. Remember in Philippians 2, 5-7, it says, "Let this mind be in you that was also in Jesus, who humbled himself and became the Son of Man." He humbled himself. In other words, he emptied himself. He put away his kingly robe and he became a man just like you and me. What we've got to realize is that in Jesus' life, Jesus was just as much the Son of God at the age of 10, at the age of 20, and at the age of 30. But he didn't begin his ministry until he was anointed. When did he get anointed? He got anointed when he got baptized in the Holy Spirit. When did you get anointed? When you got baptized in the Holy Spirit. See, a lot of us, all we thought, and I've said this many times, I only wanted the Holy Spirit so I could get people off my back. Because I belonged to a Pentecostal church and everybody had to speak in tongues. And so, you know, you all get to get the Holy Spirit. And I wanted the Holy Spirit for the wrong reason. But anyhow, eventually God gave me the Holy Spirit and that anointing was in me, but I didn't understand it. I didn't realize what I'd received. I didn't understand what was resident in me. And I believe that this is what God is doing in this hour that we're living in. He's starting to awaken within us the ministry gifting that's in us. And it's not just a pastor up in the pulpit. It's not just this one or the deacon or somebody else. It's every one of us. God wants to equip every one of us for the work of the ministry. That we will see a sick person, we'll start to lay hands on them. You know, can I ask you this, please? Don't go down to the morgue tomorrow and believe to raise everybody from the dead. I've seen that, by the way. I'm here. But anyway, we might think it might be great. But you see, he was at the age of 30, but he didn't begin his ministry till he was anointed. And John 2:11, King James said, this was the beginning of miracles when he turned the water into wine. This was the beginning of his miracles. At the age of 10, he would have seen all the broken people, all the distraught people. He would have, at the age of 20, 21, 22, whatever it might be, there was the same thing. But then one day, God anointed him. And from that moment on, he began to do miracles. He began to do what God had called him to do. But you've got to understand that he was a man. He turned the water into wine. Jesus had to be anointed before he could heal because he had laid aside his mighty power he had as the Son of God when he was in heaven and when he became a man. If this was not so, no one else could minister this way, the way Jesus did. He would have been in a class of his own. He would have been the Son of God operating on this planet with the mighty presence of God, but he could have done that at age one. He could have done that at age two, but God, he emptied himself. He became a man. He walked on this planet. He was tempted in every way as you and I are tempted. He had the power of God in him. He had the anointing of God on him. He would have been in a class of his own, out of reach of all humans. But I praise God today that God has made a way for you and me. Amen. Praise God, the river of anointing flows again today. That mighty river flows. Many men and women through the ages have tapped into this mighty river. That river is available for you and I. I remember going over to different places, seeing the move of God. I remember going to the Philippines. And there was just a bunch of people there, and they would begin to praise God. They begin to sing the praises of God. And as they began to sing the praises of God, this anointing from heaven started to come down. Something was activated in their hearts, and the presence of God came in. Man, I want to tell you, you just got up there and you started to preach, and the anointing flowed. People were getting healed and delivered and set free. I remember going over to Papua New Guinea and over there as the anointing started to flow, as there was a boldness, there was an authority. If there's something that I believe has to happen within you and I, is that we've got to get this fresh Holy Ghost boldness. There's a fresh authority that God wants to put on us, that we know who we are because we know who we are. Not because of any other reason, but because we know that God has anointed us. That's what I just love about Jesus when he stood there that day after he'd been tempted by the devil, but he came in the power of the Spirit, and he stood in that synagogue right in the presence of so many enemies that would have said, "Who is this bloke? Who is he?" And he said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. God has anointed me." Man, those words, I would tell you, I could just see things being untangled. And you see, you and I, we've got to stand and do the same. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me today. The Spirit of God is upon you today. God has anointed you. I believe that the Spirit of God, and our musicians, and I'm longing for the day when they get loose to a point where they just play in the Holy Ghost and take us into a realm of the Spirit, amen. Take us, just take us there. I've been there. Anybody else ever been where the presence of God just comes down? People are just we've got to restrict ourselves, because over the years people have been trained how to do things and how not to do things, and you've got to do this and you've got to do that. I tell you what, you've got to get loose. People in the congregation have got to get loose.
Amen.
We see some silly people that get up and dance stupid and do stupid things, and it stops the real thing. But I'm believing that we're going to see the real thing, where people there will get touched by the Holy Ghost, and they'll just start to dance in the presence of God. Amen. Not to make a spectacle of themselves. They might do it at the back of the hall. They might go somewhere. But the glory of God's going to come on people, and they're going to get loosed in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes. See, God moved. Got to get loose. This river is flowing today. There's a mighty river that's flowing from God. The river, the anointing that flows today. Many men and women have of age have tapped into this mighty river of the Holy Spirit, which carries healing, deliverance, wisdom, and more. The people like the Wesley brothers, the Finneys, the Coolmans, the Benny Hins, the Oral Roberts. I want to tell you, it's our turn. Amen? It's your turn.
Yes.
Put your finger in your chest there and say, "It's my turn. It's my turn, hallelujah. Stir me up, Jesus. Stir me up. Start using what you have. And God will give you the increase. Start doing something. God has given us the Holy Spirit credit card," old Doug told us this morning. Amen? What an amazing thing that was. That was a revelation. Amen? God has given us the Holy Spirit credit card. And you can go and take whatever, get whatever you want. And you know the part that he never said was that you don't have to get a bill at the end because the price has been paid in full. Hallelujah. You don't get a bill at the end of the month and you don't get a late fee. Because God has paid it all. He's paid it all. There's a river that flows from God above. There's a mighty river of God's anointing power. Friend, this nation of Australia needs a move of the Spirit of God, amen. We the church, the sleeping giant, we've got to be awakened by that fire. We've got to fan that flame that burns inside us, that will cause us to stir and rise and become who God wants us to be. The devil is a liar and a thief and a cheat. And oh man, when we were singing that song there tonight, "Take Back What the Devil Stole From Me," some people go and pick up, I went in there, and I was staggering back with it, amen. The devil stole mainly from you, amen. Family members, loved ones, finances, health, whatever it is, we're going to take it back, amen.
Yeah.
We're going to believe for God to do some things. We're going to believe for God for the youth of this city.
Yes.
We just don't want to tiptoe through the tulips with Tiny Tim youth group. We want a Holy Ghost youth group. Amen? Yes. The power of God can flow. The kids can get saved. I'm talking about saved. And you might as well get your name in the sausage roll. The church roll. Amen? Father, I just ask you tonight that by your Spirit you help us. Help us understand that, Lord, that Jesus Christ himself, Lord, he needed to be filled with the Holy Spirit because he came as a man. He was the Son of God, yes, but he was a man. Jesus always referred to himself as a man. Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? He spoke to himself because he knew that he emptied himself of all that power and all that authority, and he had to come as a man. And he had to come, Lord, relying on your anointing, relying on your presence, relying on the mighty Holy Spirit to work through him. The Bible even says if the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, if you allow him, he will quicken, he will make alive your mortal body. And my God, we need as a church, we need the refreshing wind of the Holy Ghost to blow. We need the fire to be fanned again in Jesus' name. Lord, we need to see an uprising of people. Lord, will they dare to believe you? Will they dare to believe your word? You said, these signs will follow those that believe in my name. In my name, they will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. In my name, they will speak with other tongues. In my name, they will cast out demons. In my name, if they drink any deadly thing, it shall by no means harm them. They'll pick up serpents. My God, in the name of Jesus, I pray that that name will become the name which will be printed across our thinking, my God, that the mighty Holy Spirit will flow out of us and through us. And my God, that you will touch this nation of Australia. My God, we pray for this city of the Sunshine Coast. Lord, let the revival fires burn in Jesus' name. Let the revival fire burn in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. I want to pray for somebody here right now. I don't know if it's one of you musicians or not, but if somebody come close to me then. But you've got a condition across your shoulders and it goes up into your ears, up into your head, all around your head there. Who's that person? Across your shoulders and up into your head. Come on, Billy. Holy Spirit, that's your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, that's your presence. Holy Spirit, that's your presence. That's your presence, Lord. I was looking for her, but she was gone. Holy Ghost. There's three people in this place right now, and you suffer with inferiority. You know that that's what stops you. There's many times where you wanted to step out, where you wanted to do something, but you haven't been able to. There's three people like that right now. Would you like to quickly come? I want to pray with you. Quickly. Quickly come. Come. One, two, three. That's good. That's good. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost.
Speak!